Yeah, great. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for this wonderful week that you have given us, Lord Jesus, as we start our week with this lesson, Lord Jesus. Help us to understand everything that you want us to know, Lord Jesus, as our pastor teaches, Lord Jesus. Help her with your spirit and guide her and anoint her with your anointing, Lord Jesus. As she speak your word, Lord Jesus, let the word touch our heart and let it bring forth fruit that we are supposed to bring forth. We thank you and we submit our class into it. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Dave. Thank you for leading us. And welcome. I think some of us join later. Thank you for joining in. We will pick up from where we left. I think we have completed 1 John chapter 4 in the last class. And the way John writes, it's a little, the way Paul writes, you have a continuity in what he's saying. But, you know, John seems to be, Apostle John seems to be somebody who had some themes in his heart. And he wanted to make sure that they are communicated to the people. So he touches on the theme, he talks about something else, and he kind of comes back to the same theme every now and then. Okay, so far we've seen things like, God is, and so we must be. You know, God is love, so we must walk in love. God is pure, so we must be pure. You know, God is holy, so we must be holy. So who God is, because of who he is, we can. Okay, so that seems to be something common in what John is sharing. And then you see that there is an emphasis on living the life, not just talking the talk. Okay, talking the talk is important. And for believers, for us to claim that we are believers and what has happened to us in Christ Jesus, yes, that's very, very important because that is a spiritual reality. But the positional truth, while that is there, the life has to testify. The life has to demonstrate that there has been a change that has taken place positionally in the life of a believer. So that spiritual reality has to become a natural reality also. So you find that John is addressing lifestyle issues, and it's a very, very important thing, because for us as believers, sometimes we can just focus on the spiritual. Okay, I'm praying, I'm reading the Bible, I'm doing all these things, which is great, which is also supposed to bring in that life transformation. But if there is a disconnect between the spiritual reality and the kind of life that a believer lives, you know, that's very dangerous. And you find John reminding often, you know, walk in love, walk in truth. Okay, so the life of a believer must be an example, and that is what, you know, he's saying. So apart from that, you find that John is talking about the relationship with God, okay, which a believer must maintain. So we saw we must abide with God, we must fellowship with God, we must fellowship with the Godhead. So you have the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, with whom we have that unbroken, in sync connection, right, as a believer. And that is a privilege which we have. So, that fellowship is something that a believer needs to maintain and he needs to recognize. Okay? And of course, you know, because of that kind of a connection, there is a flow of that life happening through the believer. Okay? So we've seen these are the kind of themes that are going on. And okay, just to add to that, so the upward connection is one thing. So he talks about us being connected, really well connected to God at all times. But at the same time, he talks about the horizontal connection, where we are relating to people. And we saw, I think last week only, we saw this truth that he says, look, if you say that you love God, but you don't love your own brother, how are you demonstrating that love of God in and through you? So most of what we see here is about the love of God, understanding God's love for us, and then revealing that love and releasing that love through our lives. So in many ways, you can say, you know, for some of us, we may feel, oh, God is love, love, love. You know, he's talking about very philosophical things. What manner of love the Father has, showered up, bestowed on us, that we should be called the children of God. So it may sound very philosophical. It may sound very, out of the normal, practical life. But there is a connection which John is trying to make and say that, look, this is the reality. And if we have accepted that spiritual reality and if it is working in us, real life, practical life will be a response to that. But if the everyday life is not a testimony to these spiritual truths, there is a disconnect. Okay. So our connection with God is something we can boast about. But when our connection with people is not proving that, that's not good. So he has words of encouragement here and there. And, you've understood. We've seen it. He talks about one subject and then he kind of comes back to the same subject in a couple of, just a few breaths here and there. And then he's back talking about love, love your brother. Only then, you're a child of God and things like that. So that's the style in which John is writing. So I hope you don't get confused, because it's just a manner of a style of writing which John has. Okay? If you compare it with other styles, maybe Paul, who very theme by theme, issue by issue, he takes up matters in that way. And of course, we know the background, right? Paul was trained by Gamaliel, and he's a very well-learned man, and therefore his style of writing is very different. But in John's case, he's trying to hit the same key points time and again so that the believer will not forget. And there's a lot of repetition. Okay, there's a lot of repetition. Another repetition was about us living victoriously. Greater is he who is in me than he that is in the world, right? So that is also something we saw, that he wants the believer to live a victorious life. And there is a mention of, the Antichrist, the spirit of the Antichrist, to be careful about false prophets, to test all spirits. So there is an encouragement to live right, to abide with God and also abide with people in a good manner. And at the same time, there is a warning. You can say that there is a warning. What warning? Warning to identify the wrong spirit and not to give it to the wrong spirit. Okay. So this is kind of what we have seen so far. So we will now look at chapter 5, and then we will be in a better position to move on to the next book that John wrote. So beginning from verse 1 of John 5, once again, he uses here the term born of God. So he says, anyone who is born of God, whoever believes in Jesus Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves him who begot also loves him who is begotten of him. So, the theme of the Trinity also runs commonly through what John is writing. Once again, he says that anyone who believes in Jesus Christ. Now remember, in the previous chapter, we saw he was warning us about the spirit of the Antichrist. Okay, and he said that when we don't confess, because the spirit of the Antichrist will not confess Jesus as Lord. But opposite to that, he's saying when we confess Jesus is the Christ. Jesus is the Christ, meaning Jesus is the anointed one. Jesus is the Messiah. Okay. So when that confession is made, so whoever believes that Jesus is the Messiah, obviously they are born again. Remember, we referred earlier also to what John wrote in the book of John, John 1:12. We know that anyone, if you believe in the Lord Jesus, you become a child of God. You believe in him, you receive him, you become a child of God. So again, he's saying the same thing. This is about the born again experience. So when you believe in Jesus as what? As the Christ, then you are born again. So born of God is what? Nothing but born again. And obviously, Jesus explained this in John chapter 3 and said that this is the work of his spirit. This does not mean that a man you know, gets into his mother's womb and has to be born again. No, but it is a spiritual birth that takes place as a work of the Spirit when somebody accepts the Lord Jesus as his personal Savior. And he says, once again, the emphasis here is about the love and fellowship with the Godhead. So he says that everyone who loves him, okay, him who begot is the Father. So one person of the Godhead. So if you say that you love the Father, then this person who is born again, who believes in Jesus, must also loves him who is begotten of him. So that word begotten there is born, right? So here there are two born. One is the human beings who accept Christ as their personal Savior, who are born of God. But begotten refers to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now we know that there is only begotten Son of the Lord, of the Father, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. So he's saying if you say that you love God, then you must also love the Son, right? And that is the emphasis there. He says, by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. Okay, so you see his way of communicating is a little overlapping here and there. So he says, by this we know that we love the children of God. Again, he has already made the point that we must love people as well. Okay, he's already made that point. Now he said, you should love the Father. You should, if you're born again, you should love the Father. You should love the Son. Now he's adding here, you must love the people of God. So children of God is who? The people of God, or in the terms of the apostles, when you read, you know, John writing or Peter writing, they use the term brethren, or the people who are in the family of God, who are all born again. So he says, by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God. Okay, so he has all earlier said that in the other way, when he said that if you say you love God, you should love the people. And now he's bringing it in, rubbing it in. You know how sometimes you just rub, right? When you're cooking the salt, you put that and you just rub it inside. So it's kind of like that. He's saying, look, if you say you love God, you should love the people. And since when you love the people, you love God. Okay, so don't miss the point this way or that way. And he moves on to say that we must keep his commandments. Okay, so the action is always translating into something practical. So he says, if you love God, then God is, you know, God is, in, you know God. If you love people, you know God, because you're showing that love, you're releasing that love to the people. And now in this case, he says, keep his commandments. So isn't it unfortunate if believers, right, we as believers, we say, hey, I love God, but we don't keep his commandments. Now, you might refer to the Ten Commandments and say, oh, I'm keeping all the commandments. But obviously, when you come to the New Testament, you know, Jesus there points out the greatest commandment is love the Lord your God with all your heart. And then, you know, love your neighbor as yourself. So basically, he sums up everything within that. And we know that, you know, everything else, when you say commandments under the New Covenant, to live for God completely, that's what is required of us. That is important for us to live the life. Okay, so without us wanting to live the life, if we claim that we are born again, if we claim that we love God, if we claim that we love people, you know, it's I don't know what to say, but it's very sad, right? That we're not, basically it means that we're not walking in God's ways, and yet we claim that we love God, that we love his people. Okay, we find in the writings of Paul, you know, he addresses very specifically certain issues, and he says, look, there are the works of the flesh, right? There is strife among you, there is division among you, there is sexual immorality among you. There are, he points out, okay, these things are there. And again, you know, he points out and he says that when you do all these things, such people will not, fornicators, adulterers, right? Sodomites, he lists out and he says such people will not inherit the kingdom of God. And he says it's so sad that these things have to be named among you, right? So basically, believers not living like believers. That is a very sad thing. And you find the apostles addressing that issue in different ways. In the case of John, he just puts it this way. He says, when we say that we love God, we must keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. So again, like you would look at this in this way, when we love God and keep his commandments, he says. So it is understood, right? Like if you have a child and you think that the child is wanting to make the parents proud, or the child is obedient, or the child understands the perspective of the parents, you will know that the child is doing his or her best to study well in school and not to get into the wrong things, right? Because when they love their parents, they want to listen to what the parents have to say. And similarly, we as children of God, when God has spoken his word and he has given us certain boundaries and commandments, then the natural response when we say, okay, I love God, it should be to obey the commandments and to basically walk in his ways. Remember, we said, as he was, so we are in this world. So the way Jesus was, we want to walk pure, we want to walk holy, we want to demonstrate the power of the Spirit, live righteous, be just, and all of that. Okay. So when we say we love God, we must keep his commandments. And he adds here, he says, his commandments are not burdensome. Okay, his commandments are not burdensome. Now, when it comes to loving, okay, ask a mother who has had a baby, right? She could have had her first baby, and before having that baby, maybe she was not the kind who had had a lot of energy to take care of the child. But once the child is born, in general, you find, right, not just mothers, even fathers, you just find them going the extra mile, letting go of their sleep, or making additional things because the baby is not eating this or eating that. They're ready to cook up other, cook different, whatever it takes to feed that child, and then the baby grows. But you see them investing into that child, and you might want to ask the parents, doesn't it feel tiring to take care of this baby? Would you rather just rest it out, right, and not want to take care of the baby? But they will tell you that they are serving tirelessly because they love that child. Okay, so the parents, they can make any effort, go to any extent, because they love the child. So when there is love, right, our labor doesn't seem much. Time will just fly away, isn't it? So we are ready to do something for the ones we love. So, maybe husband, wife, you're ready to do whatever it takes, take care of the family, be there for the spouse, or similarly, if you're taking care of our parents, maybe sick elderly parents, and you feel like, how can this be done? There is love involved. And it's not that, for the onlooker, it may seem very difficult. How is this person doing so much? They're not getting tired of taking care of their loved one. But you know what? It works like that. When there is love, it's not physically, we may feel tired, but overall, it's not exhausting us. That's what it means. So, his commandments are not burdensome. When we love him, we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. So, we don't feel that God is weighing us down with the law. Okay, and more so in the new covenant, because remember Jeremiah had prophesied, and he had in the book of Jeremiah, we read this under the new covenant, we are told that God will write the law on the hearts of the people. Okay, and you know, the in the new covenant, we know that Jesus said that he has not come to burden us and all. He has come to reinforce the law, but in a different way. And in the new covenant, the beauty of it is we have the Holy Spirit. We are inspired. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So we carry that conquering spirit. So when the commandments are given to us, it's easier to actually walk in them, be obedient and be victorious. I don't know how many of you heard Pastor's sermon yesterday, but it was about, you know, this law of the Spirit. This law of the Spirit, when the law of the Spirit is at work in us, we are overcomers, we are victorious, we are triumphant. Okay, and that is why John says, look, we love God, so we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. And additionally, in the new covenant, we have the empowering work of the Holy Spirit in us. Okay, so all the more a believer. You know, it's like trying to convince the believer, live victorious. But the reality is that the believer is already victorious. You know, it's amazing. It's amazing that the apostles have to do this. But what they want the believer to do is renew their minds. That look, this is what God has done for us. He has already given us everything we need for a victorious life. And we can be victorious. Now, moving forward, he says, whatever is born of God overcomes the world. But the same thing that I'm saying, that we are victorious. Let's renew our minds to that. We are victorious. We are victorious over everything. We are victorious over sin. We are victorious over Satan, right? We are victorious over sickness. We are victorious over death. Because we are born of God, or we are born again. And he says, whatever is born, meaning every believer, any believer is victorious and can overcome the world. So, you know, when you see the world out there, there can be different challenges. And we've seen that in 1 John chapter 2, where, you know, he talks about the temptations that this world throws at us. But for a believer, it's just a question of overcoming anything that comes his way. Okay, so wherever we are positioned, in the family, certain things are happening, we can overcome. In the workplace, certain things are happening, we can overcome. You know, in the environment around us, certain things are happening, we can overcome. Because it's so clear here, whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world. What is it? Our faith. Okay, so just now I talked about the love, and I said, hey, when there's love, everything is possible. So when we love God, we will know how, or rather we will be willing to make every effort to live according to his commandments. Now, if you go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, there these three things remain: faith, hope, love, right? And John seems to be speaking of that in his book here. Love, he has mentioned. Another aspect that he's showing here is the faith aspect. And he's saying, see, we can overcome the world. But you know what element is necessary for us to overcome the world? Faith. Okay? Faith, when we become born again, the Bible talks about saving faith. We need at least that much faith to be saved. So anybody who's born again, they are born again only by faith. They had that saving faith to be able to come into the kingdom of God. Now, in addition to that, you know, they can carry faith for very many things in life. Okay? And faith, you know, it's an entire subject here in our Bible college. It's a full course. So there is so much to talk about faith. But when we live by faith, what is the benefit of that? We overcome the world, right? So at any given point, you know, we may be standing at a place in our lives where we think, hey, I have nothing. Everything is gone, or I feel like there is a loss that I'm experiencing. But as you look ahead, you know, if you have faith, the path ahead of us will begin to open up. Because where there is faith, we can overcome. But if there is no faith, even if you have all the resources, without faith, it is impossible to please God. So what is God looking for? God is looking for faith in us. And when there is faith, you know, that becomes the source of a victorious life. So think about this. You know, God has already done everything we need for us to be victorious. And he's calling us to just walk by faith, and we can overcome the world. Who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? So again, you know, he goes back to that spirit of God. Remember, we said the Antichrist will say that, you know, Jesus is not the Christ. We saw one of the beliefs that was there during John's time, where there were Gnostics who said that Jesus was not man. Okay, but John addressed it in the last chapter, and he said, no, he is very much a human being, because it's only when we know that Jesus was fully man and fully God, you know, that we are able to establish that he is the Christ. And when we confess that he is the Christ, you know, we can only confess that by the Holy Spirit. Now, he's moving on to kind of bring in a slightly different subject here. So he starts talking about Jesus. Okay, few verses earlier, he said that a believer must love the Father, but the believer must also love the Son. Okay, now he is talking about the Son here, and he says, he who came by water and blood. Okay, so he who came by water and blood, there are many ways of looking at the meaning of that. So some people say many who came by water and blood, would it mean that Jesus was baptized in the water and Jesus shed his blood on the cross? But it says like he who came by water and blood. So the most accepted meaning of this is that Jesus was human. Okay, Jesus was human. So again, remember in the earlier passage, he addressed that issue that Jesus was human. Again, he's saying, he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, and he says, not only by water, but by water and blood. So he's reiterating that Jesus came in the flesh. And he says, it is the Spirit who bears witness, the Spirit of truth. And he says that the Holy Spirit is the one who bears witness about Jesus, and he's the Spirit of truth. Now, these words, you could take it straight off of Jesus's mouth in John chapter 14 and John chapter 15. John himself, he writes about this when Jesus said, you know, the Spirit of truth will come, he will glorify me, he will take of what is mine and he will, you know, give it to you. So he's describing the primary task of the Holy Spirit. And he's saying the Spirit, what does he do? He bears witness, okay, that what? Jesus is Christ, and that he is the Spirit of truth. Okay? And we are quite clear about that. Now, he also says there are three that bear witness in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. So he throws in a subject on the Trinity over here. And it seems a little confusing because he says there are three that bear witness in heaven. Okay. There has been a lot of study on that. Why does he say there are three in heaven? However, in the Greek, apparently, it does not really say that there are three in heaven. So that term heaven, seems to be an addition in the later translations. So a more accurate way of this reading the scripture from the original Greek would be for there are three that bear witness. Okay, so not to get drawn into that heaven, which is mentioned over there, but there are three that bear witness, and I think that is plain to understand. The spirit, there are three that bear witness. Bears witness. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. Okay, that's the Trinity. The Word is nothing but Jesus. And there are three that bear witness on the earth: the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree as one. Okay. So So we do understand that it's all basically testifying together. The in the first context here, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we know that is the harmony, the unity, the love, and the fellowship of the Godhead. Okay, and they all agree, they are in agreement. So the Holy Spirit will not say something which is not in line with the Word of God. Okay, and Jesus never did something which he did not see the Father do. All right, so in that manner, they are all very much in agreement with one another. And we find here that the other three that bear witness is the Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit, the water, and the blood. Okay, so these three agree. Just a moment here. Okay, so the water and the blood simply has to do with the Lord Jesus again. Okay. And the Holy Spirit obviously is the witness of the Lord Jesus also. So we see the unity of all of the Godhead and the water and the blood of, you know, witness that talk about the Lord Jesus. Okay, so any question on this or any doubts on this before we go further? I think the first part is clear, isn't it? I hope you all are hearing me.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So any doubts or any question? No questions. Okay, so then should I just move forward?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. All right. Okay. So we've seen the witness to the Christ. Now, from verse 9. So if we receive the witness of men, he says the witness of God is greater. So why is he talking about the witness of the Godhead? Why is he talking about the witness of the Spirit and the witness of the Lord Jesus himself? Because he says blood and water, right? Because he's trying to make a point about us receiving the witness of God above the witness of men. So now he's coming to that. He says, if we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. So we must listen to what God is saying, and especially about Jesus Christ. Witness of God is greater, for this is the witness of God which he has testified of his Son. So, what witness is God giving? Or here, when we see the term God, it generally refers to the Father. The Father is bearing witness to the Son. We just saw earlier in the previous verse that the Holy Spirit gives witness. Okay, but now the Father is giving witness to the Son. He who believes in the Son of God has the witness in himself. He who does not believe God has made him a liar. So he says, look, then God is testifying and he is saying that Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus is the Christ, Jesus is the Redeemer, Jesus is the Savior. And, you know, he is the one who has become that atoning sacrifice for us, and we reject it, right? The rejection of Christ as the Christ. When we do that, what are we doing? He says, God is a greater witness. We are ready to believe the witness of man, but who's greater than anybody else? God. And when we reject the person that God is trying to, reveal to us as the Christ, he says, we treat God as a liar. Okay, have you seen this earlier? Does he say this, God, you make God a liar earlier also? How about you? You search and tell me. Do you see this anywhere earlier in 1 John that you make God a liar?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. I will leave that as a homework for you. You just check it out. So in this case, if you don't believe the witness of God, that Jesus is the Son of God, he says that, you know, you make God a liar. So, because you're rejecting what God is confirming, okay? And the testimony which God has given about his own Son. Okay, and this is the testimony. He says, God has given us eternal life. And where is this life? This life is in his Son. Okay, so this eternal life, or the God kind of life, the Zoe life, it is in the Son. And we who have the Son have life. Okay, now those who are born again, this is again for us to rejoice in, a truth which we can rejoice in. We are told that when we are born again, we have the Son in us, and when this, meaning the life of the Son in us. He who has the Son has life flowing through him. And he who does not have the Son, he does not have life. So this is more about the spiritual life. Basically, the spirit man, we know from other passages of scripture that when somebody is not born again, what happens? No, they are spiritually dead. But when we are born again, we are awakened. Our spirit man comes alive, and we are awakened to the spiritual realities that, you know, God has in store for us. And we are being told here that when we have the Son, we have life. What kind of life is this? This is eternal life, or it is the God kind of life, which is flowing through us. And that is the beautiful testimony of the Father, because the Son is the Christ, and we who accept the Son, we have the life of God flowing through us. And so he says, these things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. Okay, so he's encouraging you by saying that because you know, you have accepted Christ. Excuse me. I want you to understand that you have eternal life, and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. So the believer must know. In other words, see here, it's just a mention about the life that we have. Okay, eternal life. But overall, he's saying we know the benefits, the spiritual truth, the spiritual realities of what has happened to us once we have received Christ Jesus. And we know that, you know, we have become so many things in Christ Jesus. So when we know these things, and we know that, you know, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world, and we know that, you know, anything that is, whatever is born of God overcomes the world, it causes the believer to live a victorious life. causes the believer to live a God kind of life here on the earth. And whatever John is saying about following the commandments, about loving God, about loving people, about living the life, everything is possible because of who we have become in Christ Jesus. So he is basically giving the assurance of having a wonderful God kind of life in the believer because of the Son of God. Now, moving on, it says, now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Okay, what a beautiful verse over here. 1 John 5:14, it says, we have the confidence, or we have the assurance, we don't have any doubts. When we ask God and we ask him according to his will, because that kind of asking will give us a result. Okay, so the end of that verse is, he hears us. So it's about a believing prayer. When we believe and when we pray, what do we receive? We receive the answers from God. So a couple of things that he points out in this believing prayer. He says, look, you already have the life of God flowing in you. Okay, and that is amazing in itself. Now, let me add to that. Okay, if you're not happy enough, I will tell you what else is amazing about being in Christ. He says that we have been given the privilege to ask. Okay, and what to ask? He adds to it. He says, anything according to his will. So what is the most effective way of praying to receive answers? What do you think? I think the answer is in the verse itself, but I'm just asking you, how to receive answers? If we ask anything, okay, are you all with me? It's a simple answer. It's there in the verse. Okay, great. So when does God hear us? One is, we should ask. If we don't ask, then we can't expect any answers. But when we ask, how to ask?
According to his will.
Very good, Arun. Yeah, so this is a key to an effective prayer life. One is, there should be a prayer life. Ask. If we don't pray, then how can we get an answer? But when we pray, how to pray? Pray according to the will of God. So when we ask anything according to his will, then what happens? He hears us. Okay, so that's what he's saying. Look, believer, you must be excited. You have the life of God flowing through you. Okay, eternal life. He who has the Son has life. Okay, now in addition to that, you can have confidence that even God answers your prayer. Wow, what a privilege, isn't it? What a privilege. So he's talking about victorious living in every aspect. You can overcome the world. You can receive answers to prayer, right? And you have the life of God flowing through you. Now we have the life of the Spirit flowing through us. Okay? And all of this makes for the believer to live a life of dominion, to live a life of authority against the evil one in this world. Okay, so what we'll do is, at this point, maybe I'll pause. If there's anything you want to add to it, any questions you have, we can discuss that, and then we will take a break, come back and move on to the following verses. So any thoughts right now? If not questions, anything that has touched you, you're thinking about it, you could just talk about that.
question?
Yes.
If God is not, if yes, you told that we should pray according to will of God. We are praying according to will of God, and but not getting answer. Then what to do?
Okay. So see.
Thing, how... And one more thing, yeah. How to know we are God? We how to know how we are going? How to know that
this is the will of God?
Yeah, what is the will of God? And is it? Are we going according to will of God or not?
Okay, so see, Manu, it's quite clear how to find out if it's God's will or not. One is by the word. So whatever you're praying for, is it all right according to the word? So if the word says that yes, it's fine, then it is in the will of God. Okay, now more specifically, the witness of the Holy Spirit. So as you keep praying about something, right, which is in the fine according to the will of God, according to the word of God, you know, God can give us, bear witness in our spirit and confirm that, okay, fine, you know, this is what God wants for us. So the word will confirm and the spirit will confirm. And we just saw that the spirit, you know, there's an agreement, right? They all agree. So the Holy Spirit will not try to compete with the word of God and go in a different direction. So that's what you have to make sure, but by the word and by the spirit, what you're praying for, that is very much accepted by God. So you know that, hey, it is in the will of God. Then sometimes when you pray in the will of God, I'm just giving you two reasons. There can be others also. I feel one is faith, right? So if we are struggling with having faith in prayer, then also we may not see answers to prayer. Okay. And the second thing is, if we have faith and we are praying, you know, for whatever reason, there could be a delay. Maybe it's not the appropriate time for something to happen. So we just have to trust and we just have to, you know, keep pressing in. Yeah. So two things. Is that fine, Manu?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, sure. All right. Okay, thanks. Good question there, Manu. On that note, let's go for a break and we will be back in about 10 minutes. So it's 9:51. We'll be back around 9:52. So 10:02, we'll be back. Thank you.